Numberless.
Okay.
Hello. Hi, Mr. Ghassan, how are you doing?
Hello, Laith, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, loud and clear.
Okay, I can hear you only through the phone, the mobile.
That's okay. It's some technical difficulties, Laith.
Laith?
Now. Hello, how are you?
Laith?
نعم.
I can't hear you على screen. I can only hear you هلا على الموبايل.
Okay. In the comments section,
لما حطيت الميوزك والكاون داون اشتغلت. I could hear you. زبط لما حط ميوزك اوكي
اتس اوكي يو كان تسمع
انت مبين انت مبين بتقعد هناك يلا شور شال اي ستارت اف يو كان هير مي ويل اند يو كان سي ماي سلايدز اي كان ستارت اوكي اوكي جريت جود افترنون ايفري ون لايث ثانك يو سو ماتش for this opportunity. As you know me, I'm very passionate about sharing my experiences and my journey, if you will, on the governance issues and sustainability. So today, what I have planned for you is to take you through some family business statistics and then talk about the journey at Nuqul Group, the way we ran the business, the separation of management from ownership, the institutionalization and so forth. And then I'll talk about the corporate social responsibility, which is in the heart of governance, the way I see it. And then I'll end up by talking about family and the family protocol and the family foundation, which are not meant by any way to boast or show off, but rather share experiences and how I saw that making a difference in my family, my business and my country looked like. So basically, as most of you know, that 30% of family businesses, only 30%, survive into the second generation. And only 20% make it to the third, and 3% survive into the fourth. And by the way, this is international statistics. This is not only from the region, everywhere in the world. So it's a matter of time before we have 97% of family businesses go away. By contrast, the importance of family businesses, they constitute 80% of the companies in the globe are family owned, and 90% of businesses in terms of numbers in North America are family owned, and 35% of the Fortune 500 family businesses are family businesses. Now, just to qualify what I'm saying, you don't have to be a privately owned company to be family business. You could be a public company, and the family can control only 25% or 30% of a business to and public to call it a family business. So you have the influence as a family. In the GCC, 75% of the companies are private sector and they employ 70% of the labor force. In the US, 60% of the employment contribution and 50% of GDP and 78% of all new jobs created were from family businesses. I have to caution that this was pre-corona. Let's move now to my own family business. The family business of the Nuqul Group was started in 1952 by my father. It used to be called Nuqul Brothers Trading Company. It was a company that was dealing with FMCGs, fast moving consumer goods, importations and distribution in the local market. It was until 1958 which witnessed the first production of paper, which was toilet paper at the time. And then between 71 and 95, there was regional expansion in the core business, which is the pulp and paper. And then between 73 and 2010, as a parallel line of activities, we went into very different diversified businesses in Jordan, the region, and elsewhere. In 2011, when you hear me talk about making a difference in my family, my business, and my country, it's a mission statement that I wrote for myself. I was fortunate to come from university to find a job waiting for me and to have a father who was waiting for me to join the business with him. And I felt that I was fortunate versus my friends who were looking for jobs. So I made this commitment on myself that I will not only enter the family business because I'm the son, but I want to make a difference. And that's this has been my motto ever since. So in 2011, it was also another milestone, I'll talk about it later on, is when we went into that level where we separated completely the ownership from running the businesses, and we did some holdings and sub-holdings for the core business and the other businesses. The way we ran the business, as my father, who was a refugee, Palestinian refugee, who came to Jordan 1948 penniless and started from below scratch, he did quite well, but very few, if you read his books, you will know that he faced numerous challenges beyond anybody could imagine. And he always said that I have two choices, either to surrender or to refuse to be defeated and come out of my problem stronger than before. It has happened until this day, we witness such a thing, and we have this motto in the group that we refuse to surrender. We always, whatever the challenge is, it was self-inflicting or external, internal, political, economic, what have you, we always have to find a way out of any challenge. So it was a one-man show, putting 16 hours a day, 7 days a week, self-made entrepreneur, risk-taker. He was self-confident, he took risk, etc. But he believed in the future. And there wasn't any formal structure. It was very centralized, and the authorities were all with him. But at the same time, he had a team of loyal employees who were loyal, hardworking, but they were not the type that they could lead and take decisions on his behalf, perhaps because he was happy and he was successful the way he was doing it. He took all the decisions, he wrote all the telexes at the time, he bought all the machines, he bought all the raw materials, he priced everything, he did everything. So there, typically, this is, by the way, a typical of self-made entrepreneur. There were no budgets, no business plans. He attended to every detail. And what happened normally in such things, if you're ambitious, because it's a one-man show or two-man show or a family run, you will run, face bottlenecks, and projects will get delayed because it's very centralized. When I joined my father in 1985, he had 4 or 5 companies. Between 85 and 96, we went from 5 companies to 26 companies. And again, it was a one-man show. It became a two-man show. So you could imagine for me as a newcomer, to learn the business, I was 4 years in the plant, every morning, 6:45 in the morning, in the afternoon in the offices, working with him. He was very ambitious. We started expanding. I was hardly learning the business here, trying to solve problems, trying to institutionalize the business, document everything, and we were running at sonic speed. So we became the bottleneck because every decision had to come to us. Every appointment has to come to us. Every problem, every signature had to come to us. It was not sustainable, to be honest. So it became obvious to me that as somebody who wants to make a difference, if I continue to complain to my father, although he agreed with me, but I expected, how naive of me, for him to make that change. Then it dawned on me that I should make the change and present it to him in a professional manner, which I did. And I have to say, I was very fortunate that he believed in me, he trusted my judgment, although at times there were different to what he was used to. It was not his habit to give authorities, to delegate, to...
Mr. Ghassan, this is such a difficult transition. I mean, you really overcame so much with this transition.
Yes, I'm going to tell you something about it. It took two. One is I was lucky that he believed in me, and to him as a smart man, it made sense. But at the same time, I had to prove to him that, you know, trust me, let's do it, and it's going to work. And it was on me to prove to him that it's going to work. And you could imagine with a group that was growing at this fast pace, and you all know doing businesses in different countries in the region is, to say the least, is challenging. Let alone to make the difference in such a short time and to have the team come up to that or rise up to the occasion or to the challenge that you need them to be on the same wavelength. So it was really challenging, I would say frustrating at times, but we stayed the course, and in my mind, there was no other way at that time. We needed to proceed. So why the separation, you ask me? I'll tell you, the separation of management from ownership in 2004 was the most important decision I made in my career. Again, I'm lucky that my father blessed it. Why? Because I'll give you some reasons. First of all, we have a myth in family businesses that if you are the owner, you are the most qualified. If you are the owner, you know it all. This is so untrue. In fact, if you are smart, you will bring people who are smarter than you so that you can delegate to them and move. So the owner's myth that you have to have everything centralized, everything comes to you, is ridiculous. As I mentioned earlier from experience, we became the bottleneck. Projects were delayed for years, not months. Plus, there's so much time that you could spend in a day in the office or in the plant. We didn't have enough time to run 26 companies as two people. Also, another, in my mind, disadvantage is when you are too emotionally attached to any business, you become irrational about decisions, strategic decisions. What I mean by that is you can be so passionate about the business, but in my humble opinion, you need not to be emotionally attached. If it makes sense to close down a recurring losses business, close it down. If it makes sense to sell it, sell it. If it makes sense, business sense, to go public. But don't keep clinking into it because it's like a baby. You started from scratch. It carries your name. And that, in my mind, I'm not saying always, more times than not, does not serve the business very well. Plus, when family members are involved in the business, the relationships get involved. How can you hold a family member accountable? If your cousin comes to the office at 11 o'clock instead of 8 or 8:30, what are you going to do? You have two choices. Either you hold him accountable like all the employees, and you lose him as a cousin, and you lose his mother and father and what have you, or you accept it and you set a very lousy precedent. Either way is not working. So in my mind, family members can stay in the business for a limited number of years to gain experience, to educate themselves, to impact, to contribute. But in the long term, it's very dangerous. I'll tell you about it later on, that in our family business, any family member can only run as a CEO for any business maximum 3 years. Then he has to move up to the board or elsewhere. And plus, when you are so much involved in the details, in operations, more times than not, you miss the bigger picture. Where are you heading? Does it make sense to remain in that sector or that country or that business? Oftentimes, you don't have time to think about this because you are so much involved. The last point on this list is if you are going to continue to have the top position and tomorrow your daughter and son, how can you attract top caliber? Because top caliber, ambitious people want to actually take your seat, your position, and it is their right. So how could I attract top caliber if I, my father, my brother, my sons, my our nieces would occupy those positions? It's difficult. Right. Let's talk about the institutionalization journey. The objective was clear that we need to transform this business from a family business to an institution not dependent on an individual. Yes, individuals can make a difference. Individuals can facilitate, can help, can support, but the business cannot depend on individuals. And when you institutionalize, a lot of good things happen. I can tell you, post-2004, really the whole group transformed in a major way. But there was always a thin line between the institutionalization and bureaucracy, because you have system, procedures, authorities, matrix, forms, because you need to have it structured. This takes away from the volatility, from the agility. It takes away from entrepreneurial, which is the next point. So you need to really draw a nice balance between agility, bureaucracy, and being structured and entrepreneurship. You want your team to be entrepreneurial, even to make mistakes, and this is very important. We talked about our ability to attract top caliber. And there is also an important element, which is the corporate memory. It has to be documented. It cannot be in the heads of the owners. And then you come to the systems and procedures. I will tell you an example. Before, we never had a single booklet that tells you, as a newcomer to the group, what is required of you. No job descriptions, no job values, no KPIs, no budgets, no procedures, forms, training, trips, reports, negotiations, contracts. We didn't have nothing.
Most companies, they really lack a lot.
Yeah.
This company handbook is onboarding kit and welcoming new employees.
Life, you know, when you actually charge a battery and you see how whatever you are actually putting the battery in moves quickly, right? Mm-hmm. This is exactly the point. once you have systems and procedures in place, you cannot imagine how many less mistakes you will not commit, how people can move faster, how people can be more efficient, how you make sure that you have checklists on buying a machine, you don't miss out anything. Basically, you save time, money, effort, and you increase hugely the probability of success. I cannot talk enough about it. Today in Nuqul Group, we have got something called GSM, Group Standard Manual that I did, and it's online. Any new manager does not need to spend 1 week orientation. He or she can immediately link, enter into that page and pick whatever. You want to see the procedures and forms on the marketing, accounting, yeah, finance, monthly reports, sales, budget, you name it, it's all there. It makes life not only easier, much more efficient. Plus, you make less mistakes. Let's talk about the way I looked at institutionalization. So basically, all the companies were interconnected. Everything was in the head office, believe it or not. Marketing, accounting, computer, audit, commercial, sales, you name it. For all companies were centralized. So basically, the plant managers were plant managers. They were not GMs. So when we separated the emerging from ownership, every company became independent. It had independent structure, independent board, budget, financials, cash flows, sources, everything alone. Then to do that, you needed to have a proper function for control and audit. And by the way, ladies and gentlemen, let me caution you. Audit and control does not mean only financial audit. Procedural audit, processes, yeah, human resources. Because let me give you a quick example. If an employee signs a contract worth $1 million, audit, if it's not in the accounting, it's not a check, it's not... No, you need to make sure that your contracts are standardized and audit approves them. So this is one example. And then the best investment you will ever, ever make is in human capital. Make no mistake. Machines, technology, offices, computers, you can always buy them. But the human capital is what makes it or breaks it. And then I talked about the GSM, the Group Standard Manual. And then I talked about bringing independent board members with you so that they can tell you you're not doing the right thing or you're doing the good thing. And then let's talk about ethos. So it's part of the institutionalization. And then you have to instill this in the culture, in the mindset, that we have to have the best quality and service. We have to have integrity and ethics in everything we do. And we have a code of conduct, code of business conduct. We call it COBE. Every person is that big, is as good as any code of conduct document in the world today, to be honest. I'm proud of that. And we sit, including myself, a yearly test to take a test on this. Technology, that was even before, but today more so. You invest in technology all the time. Sustainability, in everything, environment, water, recycling, people, everything. You have to make sure that the business model is sustainable. Then comes the CSR. Success is a complete circle. You cannot be successful in your business and not successful in your community, in giving back to society. And I'll talk about it more. Innovation, we have to continue to transform today more than ever. Continuous transformation in every sense. And then commitment, dedication, and honesty, because people can tell and feel. You can speak, you can talk the talk, but you need to walk it. And they will find out if you're not genuine about it. So when we talk about corporate governance, in Arabic, we say, حوكمة وحكمية. It makes sense. It makes business sense. But it is institutionalization. It is to have independent consultants and advisors. It is the code of conduct. It is the corporate citizenship. It is the human capital. It is risk management with proper documents on risk mitigation and identifying all the risks because it's part of sustainability. Financial reporting every month for all companies to have a clear vision and mission and strategy to have, again, board of directors. Right. So, again, part of corporate governance is the values. Is equal opportunity. We never discriminate against color, race, religion, gender, sexual orientation, nothing. The minute you allow it, it will destroy any company, believe me. And you will not be able to bring the best caliber. In fact, we want diverse people, different people who think differently, eat differently, behave differently, as long as we share common values and ethics. And you need to reward people. They have to be part of the profit, to have profit sharing. Environment. In fact, I have case studies where I can show you that when you invest in a recycling environment, it's economically feasible. Risk. It's not only fire and theft and water, flooding. It's process, technology, people, patents, you name it, competition, transparency. People often tell me, why do we need to allow? I am willing and I want and I will. I continue to communicate everything. I have nothing to hide. Salaries, packages, ideas, people need to understand where we're heading. And then there's the compliance to make sure that you are in compliance with what makes sense, global compact on labor, on conditions, on many things. It's the UN. Then the ISO, so many ISOs, and it all makes sense. Finally, I will tell you, empirically speaking, that corporate governance has many benefits. There is more empirical evidence to show that companies which adhere to good corporate governance have higher brand loyalty among their consumers. The public markets reward them highly. Their shares are with peers are higher. The consumers will pick your product from the shelf if everything else is equal, and banks will lend you at a cheaper rate because you are less risky than others. I'm close to finishing, by the way. When we talk about CSR, it could take many forms: sponsorships, philanthropy, could be scholarships, educational, community development, environment. You decide. However, in our group, we decided we want to make a difference. I don't want to be a me too thing. So we put our criteria down. Any project we do, it has to be sustainable, impactful, has a social return in the community, empowering the people. It has to be inclusive and to be comprehensive, economic, social, educational, what have you. This is when you become a real social entrepreneurship. And in my mind, sorry.
We have someone asking a very fantastic question. Basil Khaldi, how can you manage and control toxic environments at work?
You have two options. One is to keep putting them in your face and keeping convincing yourself that they're going to be impediment to your growth and advancement, or you learn how to deal with them and put them aside and jump above them every time. It's easier said than done, but we have no choice. And I can write a book about the toxic environment and the elements of it that could convince anybody that it's not doable. But you need one good determination and reason, and it's a decision, and you refuse to succumb to it. And I can give you examples. I can talk more about the CSR project that we made in Al Qura. I'll tell you the three things. One, it's probably the most impactful, allow me to say it, pioneering, first of its kind in Jordan, sustainable 13 years, mostly about women. It's comprehensive, inclusive. It had all the tools, it ticks all the boxes, and it has sustainable element. I can tell you more about it in the Q&A if you like. Quickly, I will move the final part of my presentation is about family. You have a commitment, an obligation to make sure that family does not influence the business negatively. So you need to have governance model also for the family. So I did for my family, again, part of my mission to make a difference in my family, I did a family protocol. Basically, it's a document that all members of the family signed to it. It has a family board, family council, and family governance statements. It talks about family representation in the management. It talks about personnel policy of the family. How do they join the business if they join the business, and what are the procedures? The new investments and restrictions for family members. What if a family member wants to do his own business? There are ways and the guidelines, and the code of conduct of family members and their obligations. There's a chapter on conflict resolution. There's also a family office. And there's also a chapter on rules of exit. If somebody wants to exit from the family, you cannot stop him. How do you evaluate the shares? How do you buy it? How, etc. And finally, is the family foundation. In my mind, success needs to be crowned by a philanthropic family foundation that it will make a difference. Quickly, I can tell you more about the family employment. It's 2+ years that they have to work outside the business, and then they join. There's a procedure. If somebody has a new idea for a business, there's a way where you can entice them to do it, bring it to the family. If the board accepts it, they give you 25% equity stake in it so that you can be an entrepreneur, and we can go on and on. Competition, there's a clear guidelines on what can businesses you can enter outside the business or the family or not, and if you can use the family name, etc. How it's comprehensive, actually. By the way, it does not prevent any potential conflict, but it reduces probability. And once there is a problem, at least you have ways and means to try to solve it. Nothing is guaranteed, but you always try to minimize a probability of such things taking place. Finally, I'm proud to say that we have, as a family, established, again, back to the institutional framework, a family foundation. We named it after my father. It is basically about employability. It's about education, but the more importantly is the soft skills. We work with our youth and fellows, how to become positive citizens, employable, service their community, leaders, helping each other, networking, etc. I cannot tell you how rewarding it is. It is one of my prides that I'm doing. Last slide, my personal recommendations to all of you who are actually from family businesses or work in family business. My quick recommendations, guidelines, separate margin from ownership yesterday, have a formal board that includes family and professionals, separate business finances from the family finances, clarify the duties, responsibilities, and authorities of family members, define the clear strategy of future investments and the role of family members, make a comprehensive family protocol. I can also help you and advise you on where to go. Separate new investments, encourage people to do new investments, to learn, to become entrepreneur. Don't have everything always in the business. Let them venture out, make mistakes out, fail outside perhaps, or make it outside. Evaluate the advisability of children entering the business because it is a minefield. It is a higher probability of conflict. And then make a family council that talks about family well-being, education, retreats, what have you. Have an exit strategy, a duty to report to shareholders. It's your duty if you are leading the business. And lastly, but not least, is to devote time for family and, more importantly, enjoy it. Laith, with this, I finish my presentation. I hope I didn't speak too fast, but because I'm passionate and I'm out of time, but I'm willing to entertain any questions, suggestions, or criticism for that matter.
Well, first, I want to just express your adaptability in regards to our technical difficulties today. And I want to thank you for, deciding to stay on the line and being able to continue with this today.
My pleasure.
If anyone has any questions regarding family businesses, please type it into the comments and let us know. I took that leap of faith and jumped off of the family business in general. And I decided to launch my own business, which is terrifying. But it's starting to come together and it's starting to grow. And it actually gives me a second perspective on how to get back to the family business from an outside perspective. So now I'm growing as an individual, but I'm also helping from the outside,
Okay, because I lost you last few seconds, Laith. You're saying that when you ventured into your own business outside the family, you're able to bring some stuff for the benefit of the family business.
Yes.
Which is great and it is expected. However, I'm sure, Laith, you also today appreciate what your family members who are running the family business face on daily basis, and the challenges and the hard work and the perseverance and sacrifice it takes to succeed. Because sometimes the passive family members, when they sit back and are not involved, it might sound and feel easy for them to make profits or success. You know, we invested and we made money. But people need to understand and feel that nothing is easy. And things require perseverance, hard work, sacrifice, security, inner security, and, and accepting failures, because you cannot succeed in every time. If you succeed 70% of the times, that's brilliant. So, but people sometimes, not only family members, but even partners, when you succeed 7 out of 10, they always focus on the 3, they forget the 7, which is fine. But I think once you run and venture into your own business, you see it differently.
Absolutely. And it was a very fascinating experience. But even more so, you were saying how there needs to be a separation between ownership and management. And in regards to that, it's easier said than done because people tend to get very emotionally attached. And I feel that the emotional attachment makes things a lot more difficult than they need to be.
Yeah. Remember, Laith, when I talked about the difference between being passionate about the business and emotionally attached. There's a huge difference when it comes to business. Emotionally attached, in my mind, my dictionary, you become at times irrational. Not always, but you could become irrational. What makes business sense is not a priority. What makes emotional sense, what satisfies your emotion, your pride, takes precedent to what makes business sense. And this is dangerous. But you can be passionate. Put your heart into it, and that's one of the ingredients of success, no doubt. The second point is, whatever we say, emotions get involved. when family members are running the business. Because if me and you want to go to Aqaba, you might decide to drive on the Dead Sea, I might drive on the desert road, and somebody else might take a plane. There are three ways, three are right. But what happens is this is where the conflict starts. Each one wants it his own way, although at the end they might reach the same destination. And the rest becomes history. So this is where it starts, and it takes forever to solve it, and then it ruins the business. And look at the statistics. So my recommendation, really, as hard as it may sound, is not to encourage family members to get involved in the business. You don't stop them. It's their right to apply. But because it's a matter of time, especially if you have cousins and second cousins, it takes one. It takes one individual to make it crazy. And however, if somebody is qualified, they can become board members and they get involved. They can be part involved in the philanthropy. They can be involved in certain things. But I feel from the statistics and from my exposure, I attended so many and I spoke at so many international, regional family businesses. It's common among all businesses worldwide. Few, 3% only survive. Imagine. Lastly is accountability. Of course, we talked about it. But more importantly, I want the interest of the family means that you recruit the best caliber no matter who or she is. So if the family's interest is better and more important than the individual interest, then I want to recruit the best caliber outside the family. Unless you're one of those families who you have geniuses and you cannot do without them, which I doubt. And you can have one genius. So you are limiting the possibility of greater success because you're limiting yourself to family members.
Excellent. Thank you so much. I seem to be having creating an echo effect.
Laith, I can't hear you. Sorry, Laith.
I seem to be creating an echo effect from my end for the listeners.
Okay.
All right. Does anyone else have questions? Here's one.
Musa, very good question and a tough one. You have to decide, Musa. If, as you mentioned, he does not or she does not fit, therefore keeping her or him in the business is not going to work. It might start with a small gap or hole, and this problem becomes bigger and bigger. The earlier you address it, the better it is. But you need to be fair and you need to be clear and transparent. Meaning, when you say he doesn't fit, you should have in place what are the criteria for people to fit in the organization. It has to be clear. Maybe he or she does not know. So you have to do your homework. You have to have structure, clarity, transparency, communication, clear communication. And then if still the problem exists, you have to face it, talk to him out of it, and deal with it. 95% of the time, he or she, when he leaves, they're going to take it back on you. His father, mother, your cousin is not going to talk to you over a Friday lunch, what have you. But you have a choice to make. You have a choice to make it tough. Being in a leadership position requires you to make tough calls for the benefit of the whole family. Again, I repeat, Musa, the whole family's interest is more important than individual family member interest. Keep thinking about that. And this is what should dictate your action. And bring it to the family council so that you're not the only one. Like in my case, I'm the chairman. I don't want to take that decision. I can bring it to the family council. Maybe they see it differently. Maybe I'm missing something, or they make my decision more right, and it's a collective decision rather than one decision.
Well, that was a fantastic answer. Thank you, Mr. Ghassan. We also have another one here. And this one is a tough decision.
Rakan. Hi, Rakan. The hardest decision was the separation of management from ownership in 2004. Remember, guys, my father is a self-made man who started from below zero. To come to him and tell him, Dad, please don't call financial managers in the company. Don't call HR. Don't call this one. You can only call the GM was very tough, extremely tough. But because it's the right thing to do, I owed it to himself, I owed it to myself, I owed it to my family, I owed it to my business to do what is right. And I'll tell you something, Rakan. You know Abu Ghassan. He's not because he's my father. Now he's my boss. I tell you, I talk about him as my boss, not as my father. He's intelligent. He's progressive. He adapts. And he believed in me, which I was lucky, but I had to prove myself. So it took two. It was very tough because along the way, when you started delegating, giving authorities, people were buying machines, huge amounts, people taking decisions. And one time he came to me, he told me, what? Did we sell the company without me knowing? You know, making a complaint. I told him, Baba, we made mistakes. But on the other side, we made much better decisions. We made five mistakes, our team made. But on the other side, we made 100 good decisions because of the separation. So it was very tough. It took time. It took really agony. It was not easy. And I wanted to prove it to myself, to the family, to him. And it made sense. And finally, it was the best thing that I did in my life, in my career. But I thank him, really. I'm grateful and fortunate that he allowed me. He adapted his way to my way. Not to my way, but to the right way at the time, to be honest.
Yes. And you know, him being able to place that much trust is never easy.
Yeah. 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 Laith, I will share something personal with you. And this is coming from my heart now. And I mean every single word. Because of the agony and the sacrifice and the challenges this man as a refugee faced in his life gave me the strength and power and determination to continue on his footsteps and his legacy, no matter what. It started from my young childhood. I wanted to get him grades and do sports and be on the sports team and play music and do it without me, you know, admitting it in my psychology to make up to him, to be proud, to be happy of his son. Of course, I benefited in the tawjihi, in college, when I did, allow me to boast, I did quite well in college. It was because of him, for him. And that was my way in rewarding him without me, you know, acknowledging that this, it was inside of me. It was the drive. Until today, my drive is to continue his legacy and to make up for the agony, sacrifice he did for us, to be honest.
Wow. And that is a very good, incredible. Sorry, I'm speechless. And of course, we have another question, which I think is quite interesting.
Very good one. Right. Ahmed, empirically speaking, family businesses in tough times and in crisis, they do much better for obvious reasons. It's your own money. You can always take the decision, take the risk without complicating matters and being accountable. And you don't have the time in crisis to answer for shareholders, to authorities, to what have you. This is one, but sometimes it could be a negative, but in general, I'm assuming it's a good family business, successful. Second, you use all your means, all your contacts in the service of business. If a public company, I own 30%, I'm the chairman, and I consider it a family business that I control the majority, I will not put my own money in bad times to bail out this company. But if it is my own family business, I'll sell my watch to support it. That's the second thing. The third thing, normally, it's for the long run. It's for sustainability. Public companies, in general, tend to want to make sure that the annual report and the market, financial market, gets the news right on time. Because if you don't deliver this year, they might oust you as a chairman. While you might be doing the right thing for the long term, I'll give an example. If there is a huge investment you want to embark on that will cause you losses 2 years in a row, for you to make it up big time in the third, fourth year, believe me, it's very difficult in publicly traded companies. In family businesses, it's your decision. You can make it. You can take the risk and be accountable to your own self as well. Because if you don't, the accountability is implicit. Because if you don't make money, then you will personally suffer and your family will suffer. Now, that does not mean that you will make the decisions alone. You need to have the right people with you, the right managers, right advisors, right board members, consultants. Make no mistake. But at least you can make a quick decision and take responsibility. But at the end of the day, whatever we say, it's how you run the business, not what the business is. So basically, you have family businesses who failed for obvious reasons, and the same with non-family business failed. On the other hand, certain family businesses, you know, thrived, and public companies thrived. So it's how you do it. It's not what type of company it is. But I gave you some of my insights and empirical points about family businesses.
And of course, you know, we can't. A lot of us need to have a transparent conversation. It starts with a conversation. We have interviewed Mr. John Yeager, and he has given us that point. But being transparent can't just come from one person, it has to come from the entire family as well. About your intentions, about your vision, about your feelings, about everything.
Correct. That is correct. Although remember, like when I've attended many of those conferences and my readings, because of the emotional aspect, sometimes these issues become blurred, right? You know, people get blurred because oftentimes a family, passive family member who is not business savvy or cannot read financial statements, cannot get a grasp, real grasp of the company. They can probably look at your debt, for example, and say, oh my God, and they cannot sleep at night without realizing that debt to equity ratio is very little. So this is the problem, and there are chapters and books and journals on educating family businesses to become responsible investors. Because sometimes the lack of experience, lack of exposure could hinder you, let alone stop you from moving. Because at the end of the day, they're shareholders. And you cannot continue to fight everybody and you claim that you are the only one who understands it. So you are fortunate if the family members are investment savvy, responsible shareholders, exposed. And that's why I said encourage family members to do their own businesses so that they know, they relate, they learn, and they can reflect and understand more what it takes. But also, I would say that at the same time, you need to listen to them, understand where they're coming from. And in my analysis, it's always a good practice to bring an independent advisor if you have different opinions. Listen to your opinion, their opinion, and let him or her speak. Because if me and you, Laith, are discussing and arguing, it's your word against my word. Sometimes we become blinded. We keep thinking of what to answer rather than how to absorb. But when you hear it from an independent, unbiased, professional, respected advisor for the family, it goes a long way. And this is a good practice I always recommend families to consider.
True. Very true. And, you know, we just got another question, which is very interesting.
They're becoming more difficult.
They're becoming more difficult. I think this will be the last one we take for the night. Here you go. This one is a tough one.
Wow. The most important, okay. Can I combine them together, Yusuf, and list a few of the points that I think are non-negotiable? Number one is ethics. No compromise on ethics. Second is attitude. I think for managers and leaders, the minute the attitude is not perfect, you know what I'm saying? يعني the attitude, مش عارف أشرحها بالعربي. It is there. شفت الحال مش عارف مين أنا إعناد insecure all of this attitude you have to have positive attitude and with it comes security and self confidence okay third hard work fourth ego put it outside the door if somebody gives you a better idea than yours withdraw yours immediately and move forward fifth connections are very important sixth exposure travel, be aware, be in touch. Seven, work on yourself. Eight, have a hobby. Nine, play sports. 10, have good friends. 11, travel, leisure, change, etc. But, in my opinion, each person, whether a leader and an employee, need to understand what is my mission? What is the legacy I want to leave? Is it 9 to 5 and go home? Or is it make the work better place or improve the company, improve my department, improve, help my country? One has to find that thing. I found it. It came, believe me, it came naturally to make a difference. So this keeps you going. But these are, Yusuf, there are many, but these are off my head, are the things, and go into details. Delegate, empower, believe in people, be happy. By the way, I'm not suggesting I have them all. I'm guilty of not having some of these. I'm working on myself. But as long as you're aware of them.
Well, I think everyone is always working on themselves and trying to reach it. I think the wisest people will say, learning never stops, developing, self-development never stops.
Yeah. I would add 2 points that you reminded me now. Be prepared, be prepared, be prepared. Always.
Yes.
Yeah. We always say that when you go into negotiations, you win the battle before you enter the meeting. Means that how much you prepared, you will have the higher chances of winning. Don't be afraid of making mistakes. We always say, there's a nice saying, I love it. It says, good judgment comes from experience. Experience comes from bad judgment. But learn from our mistakes. We all make mistakes. Make no mistake.
Well, I mean, like this one, we adapted to the situation.
You bet.
And we did good. Thank you so much, Mr. Ghassan. And I really appreciate having this very, extremely valuable insight onto family business, onto corporate governance, and a lot of businesses in the Middle East are here.
Laith, thank you so much for this opportunity. It really was an honor and pleasure. I enjoyed it. And, you know, I just want to say that I spoke from my heart. Anyone would like to reach out for any specific issues, I'm willing. I'm always willing. And I thank you and Leaders Talk, the platform, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you so much, and God bless.
Thank you.
Thank you.